Amistad and Harper Audio present The Cooking Gene, a journey through African-American culinary history in the Old South. Written and read by Michael W. Twitty.
Preface. The Old South. Negroes in the North are right when they refer to the South as the Old Country. A Negro born in the North, who finds himself in the South, is in a position similar to that of the son of the Italian immigrant, who finds himself in Italy, near the village where his father first saw the light of day. Both are in countries they have never seen, but which they cannot fail to recognize. The landscape has always been familiar. Everywhere he turns, the revenant finds himself reflected. He sees himself as he was before he was born. He sees his ancestors, who in everything they do and are, proclaim his inescapable identity. And the Northern Negro in the South sees, whatever he or anyone else may wish to believe, that his ancestors are both white and black. James Baldwin, Nobody Knows My Name, A Letter from the South. The Old South is a place where people use food to tell themselves who they are, to tell others who they are, and to tell stories about where they've been. The Old South is a place of groaning tables across the tracks from want. It's a place where arguments over how barbecue is prepared, or chicken is served, or whether sugar is used to sweeten cornbread, can function as culinary shibboleths. It's a place in the mind where we dare not talk about which came first, the African cook or the European mistress, the Native American woman or the white woodsman. We just know that somehow the table aches from the weight of so much that we prop it up with our knees and excuses to keep it from falling. The Old South is where people are far more likely to be related to one another than not. It is where everybody has a Cherokee, a Creek, a Chickasaw, a Seminole, or a Choctaw lurking in their maternal bloodlines. But nobody knows where the broad noses or big asses come from. It is a place where dark gums and curly hair get chalked up to lost Turks and meandering mystics. But Nigeria and Gambia are long forgotten, unlike everything else that is perpetually and unremittingly remembered. Proud bloodlines of Normandy and Westphalia and County Armagh and Kent endure here, and like it or not, it is often in the bodies that bear no resemblance to those in whom those genes first arrived. Bodies like mine. The Old South is a forgotten little Africa, but nobody speaks of it that way. Everything black folks gave to the aristocracy and plain folks became spun gold in the hands of others, from banjos to barbecue, to Elvis to rice and cotton know-how. Everything we black Southerners kept for ourselves, often the unwanted dregs and markers of resistance, felt like markers of backwardness, scratches of the uncivilized, idolatry, and the state of being lost. And yet I loved that Old South, and loved it fiercely in all her funkiness and dread. To be honest, I never hated white people for their strange relationship to us, their colored kith and kin. But I grew up with the suspicion that they had no clue just how much of us there was in their family trees and stories and bloodlines and on their groaning tables. Maybe if they did, we would know less enmity toward one another. The Old South is where I had to return. The Old South is my name for the former slaveholding states and the history and culture they collectively birthed from the days of contact through civil rights. My Old South doesn't end when white people start recovering from the Civil War and move to southern cities and start working in mills and factories. My Old South ends when black people are formally and forcefully brought out of the 19th century, in the middle of the 20th. Maryland, Virginia, West Virginia, North and South Carolina, Georgia, Florida, Alabama, Tennessee, Kentucky, Missouri, Arkansas, Mississippi, Louisiana, Texas, and Oklahoma. Pretty much the census South. Heads may shake over this list, but my geography is determined by the fact that the South is multi-regional. Landscapes, politics, subcultures, climates, ecosystems, and crops separate Blue Ridge from Bayou Country, Chesapeake from the Ozarks, the Black Belt from the Low Country, the Delta from Bluegrass Country, and Middle Tennessee. Old South culture is also not bound by growing up in the former Confederacy. Where are you from in the South? Privileges, settlements, and cities, not to mention the white folks' version of what, quote-unquote, Southern means. The former Confederacy is not the totality of the South or Southern culture, and the Deep South is younger than the Seaboard and Upper South. The prominent cities of the New South, while markers of the Sun Belt, are not really where the vernacular culture of the South came to be. It was in the wide swaths of densely populated rural country, often not far from rivers, where the elements came together. In 2011, I remembered that I had started to forget where I came from. I became aware of my own apathy and amnesia. I had a responsibility to study the generations before me and use that to move forward. So I worked with my then partner to craft a crowdfunding campaign called the Southern Discomfort Tour. My goal was for us to travel the South, looking for sites of cultural and culinary memory, while researching my family history and seeing the food culture of the region as it stood in the early 21st century. There are giant peaches on top of towers, and statues of boll weevils and giant mammies, and country stores that sell pig parts aplenty, and have coolers that can keep a deer carcass or a mess of largemouth bass cold for 3 days. Nothing can prepare you for the sea of green cane or rice or tobacco, or the way cotton looks when it's young and bushy and putting out mallow-like blossoms. The road signs are clear. Three crosses on a hill. Get right with God. Signs for cans of field peas and succotash, buffet-style halls, and meet and threes off the highway, and nondescript adult entertainment centers. Old plantations lend their name to actual historical sites on the brown landmark signs, as well as to apartment complexes and resorts, and battlefields are everywhere. In some town centers, the auction blocks are remembered. From the town I lived in Maryland to Oxford, Mississippi, the Confederate soldier stands guard near the old courthouse, and people will point out to you where the hanging tree stood or stands. There is a lot of beautiful and a lot of ugly mashed together. Pecan trees are my favorite thing, and they stand guard over my grandfather's home in South Carolina. Nothing matches light, filtering through Spanish moss in the latest part of the day. The elders talked about how beautiful this place was, and if you are lucky, you will learn why they left it and what that first taste of northern cold was like, and the realization some things were no better no matter where you lived. In the words of my maternal grandmother, the day I learned up north wasn't streets paved with gold and that white people there could be just as bad was the day I learned that sometimes the grass is greener because there's more shit to deal with. But she missed the crepe myrtles, and my grandfather missed the taste of ripe cane nabbed from a neighbor's yard. I had come to see it all for myself. It's a misnomer, the Old South. The South has never been still or merely aged. It is not stagnant, and it is not as set in its ways or physical boundaries as much as some people would like to pretend. Perhaps there is nothing old about the South except its heirs. Mississippi, Alabama, Georgia, Arkansas. Old? The first two were barely middle age. Georgia was just starting to think about being emeritus, and Arkansas was in puberty when the war between the states, because real Southerners don't say the Civil War, broke out. The New South waits for us, but it's less place than lingering idea. And the postmodern South? Who cares? Nothing is made there. In our minds, nothing is like the Old South, home of the original American rebel. The Old South was introduced to me in movies and magazines as the bizarre place we Black Americans owed our identity. Untanned, ageless white ladies in pastel crinolines, Carolina blue, pale jessamine yellow, dogwood blossom pink, mint julep green, bedazzled with stars and bars and frills aplenty. Parasols and fat Black crones called mammies, and crusting, crooning, near-senile ex-bucks, fondly called uncle. Everybody and everything was satisfactual and in their right place. White men in white columns and bow ties on white suits, the kind you'd never dream of getting chicken gravy or whipped blood on. Blemishless and benign, a patriarchy overlooking a peaceable racial hierarchy, ordained by a creator with a permanent beef with Cain and Ham. And then Joshua butted in. Now, therefore, ye are cursed, and there shall none of you be freed from being bondmen, and hewers of wood and drawers of water for the house of my God. Hewers of wood and drawers of water. The Oprah Winfrey Show, 1987. Oprah goes to Forsyth County, Georgia, where no Black person had been allowed to live in 75 years. She had been on the air 5 months. Confederate battle flags were on display. A people unreconstructed came out in force to show America's future richest Black person where she stood. What seemed like the entire town showed up to justify their whitopia. No racial description whatsoever appears in the scripture for Cain or Canaan, son of Ham, and the verse from the book of Joshua has nothing to do with anyone living in America. And yet a man had his Bible open, ready in 1987 to justify a permanent and seemingly ancient division that did not exist in the British mind before the late 16th to mid-17th centuries. My Alabama-born and raised grandmother, a refugee of, quote, Birmingham, is folding clothes. Under her breath is a constant stream of God damn them. Her breath slowed to a seethe, and her eyes became fixed into what seemed like a cut from which she would never return. I was 10, and I was barely taught in school that in my own area, the Washington Metroplex, slavery and racism had defined the economy, politics, and social order. Seeing this made me dread my own country and presumably my own ancestral homeland, the Old South. The lazy, laughing South with blood on its mouth. And I, who am Black, would love her, wrote Langston Hughes. A refugee of Joplin, Missouri, the poet laureate of Black America. The poems I was bid to remember frequently referenced a place that was caught up in a weird braid of nostalgia, lament, romance, horror, and fear. Forsyth County, Georgia, is no longer the same place it was nearly 30 years ago, and Black people have long since moved in. And yet across the region, flashpoints continue. The shootings, the draggings, the overreach of police authority, the obstruction of the vote, inequalities and inequities, and silent and sturdy boundaries between white and Black. For some, we are the South, but they are Dixie. And yet we and they all know the old hanging trees, and the strange fruit they once bore. I dare to believe all Southerners are a family. We are not merely Native, European, and African.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.